Hi, my name is Kim Daniels, and I'm with Georgetown University's Initiative on Catholic Social Thought and Public Life. We're so glad to be co-hosting this gathering on Religion and Race, the Future of Anti-Racism and the Catholic Church, along with Washington, D.C.'s Theology on Tap. This discussion is part of our Salt and Light series of gatherings for young Catholics exploring links between faith, Catholic social thought, and personal and professional life. It's our 15th online dialogue since COVID-19 kept us all home and took us online, in which we've covered such topics as faith and the faithful in the 2020 campaign, Pope Francis and the reform of the church, and Catholic social thought and the coronavirus crisis. We're especially proud to have hosted a major public dialogue on racism in our streets and structures with Washington Archbishop Wilton Gregory and other Black leaders in the wake of the forceful removal of Black Lives Matter protesters in front of St. John's Church here in Washington, D.C. last spring. We're so grateful to have so many young people with us tonight from around the country for this very important conversation. Moderating that conversation will be my friend Jonathan Lewis, the Assistant Secretary for Pastoral Ministry and Social Concerns for the Archdiocese of Washington and a leader in the church here in Washington and more broadly. Over to you, Jonathan.
Thanks so much, Kim. It's my pleasure to be with you. And I want to thank the Initiative on Catholic Social Thought at Georgetown University for their collaboration in co-hosting tonight's joint DC Theology on Tap and Salt and Light gathering. But before we get started, I want to go over a few housekeeping items so everyone can participate fully. First, we want to thank you for joining on YouTube Live and highlight that American Sign Language is available tonight in the corner of your screen. Thanks, Christina. And our conversation tonight will be recorded and posted on the Initiative's website for later viewing. Finally, I hope you'll share your thoughts on social media using hashtag religion and race and submit questions for our panelists by following the prompts at the bottom of the screen. I'm honored to be moderating tonight's panel on Religion and Race, the Future of Anti-Racism in the Catholic Church. The killings of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor sparked a racial justice reckoning in a way previously unseen in a generation. These recent events have led individuals to examine more closely the impact that injustice and racism have on an individual, structural, and institutional level, including in the U.S. Catholic Church. As Pope Francis reminded us just earlier this month in his encyclical letter on human fraternity, instances of racism continue to shame us, for they show that our supposed social progress is not as real or definitive as we think. This is not the first panel on the topic of racism in the Catholic Church, nor will it be the last. However, tonight's conversation stands out not only because of the excellence of our panelists, but because as Black Catholic leaders ages 40 and under, our panelists are working to shape the future of racial justice in the Catholic Church. As Archbishop Wilton Gregory shared in his recent column just last week, the energy of young people compels me to believe that there are many new champions for justice ready to continue the struggle well into tomorrow. Tonight is a conversation with four of those champions for justice. It is important to acknowledge that while the work of combating racism includes us all, it's not the responsibility of people of color to educate others on the realities of racism. And so it's with gratitude that I introduce tonight's panels and thank them for their willingness to share their experience and their expertise with us. Our four panelists begin with Dr. Shannon D. Williams, who is the Albert LePage Assistant Professor of History at Villanova University. She's the author of a forthcoming book with the working title, Subversive Habits, Black Catholic Nuns in the Long African-American Freedom Struggle. Ogechi Alkaberi is a Nigerian-American who's the creator and host of the podcast, Tell Me If You Can. She also works as a Christian Service Coordinator at Conley School of the Holy Child in Potomac, Maryland. Gerald Smith Jr. is the principal at St. Thomas Amore Catholic Academy in Washington, D.C., and a former teacher at Bishop McNamara High School in Forestville, Maryland. And Father Robert Boxey is the Catholic chaplain at Howard University in Washington, D.C., was ordained to the priesthood for the Archdiocese of Washington in 2016. Shannon, I want to start with you. While the last few months have been dramatic and raised the awareness of racism in the U.S., there hasn't really been a robust conversation about the history of racism in the Catholic Church. So, if you can try to sum up in a couple minutes, what is the U.S. Church's relationship with slavery, segregation, racism, and who are a few of these important characters in history that we should know more about? And what do they teach us about how we're called to engage this present moment?
Thank you. And thank you so much for the opportunity to engage in this conversation. I think what is important, certainly for every Catholic to understand, is that the Catholic Church was never an innocent bystander in the history of slavery, segregation, or exclusion in American society. While Catholic social teaching affirms the right to life and dignity of every person, the fact remains that our church egregiously violated those teachings through its participation in the transatlantic slave trade and the imperial practices of African slavery and segregation in the Americas, Europe, and then also in Africa. In the land area that became the United States, it's important to understand that the church itself was the first and among the largest corporate slaveholders in the land area that became the United States. Contrary to popular belief, slavery does not begin in 1619. It actually begins nearly a century before in Spanish Florida. That is where we will begin to see the first sort of long, uninterrupted history of African slavery in the land area that becomes the United States. At various moments in American history, the church is the largest corporate slaveholder in Florida, Louisiana, Maryland, Kentucky, and Missouri. I think it's also imperative that we remember that the church's earliest bishops were slaveholders, and we must also understand that the church itself, while battling anti-Catholicism, was nonetheless part of this American project of democracy. There is a Catholic signer of the Declaration of Independence in Charles Carroll of Carrollton, who was one of Maryland's largest slavers, who is also cousin to Bishop John Carroll, who is our first bishop, who himself is a slaveholder. We must also never forget that Roger B. Taney, who was the nation's first Catholic Supreme Court justice, infamously declared in 1857 that Black people, quote, had no rights which the white man was bound to respect, while denying the freedom petitions of Dred and Harriet Scott and their two daughters. Even after slavery, the Catholic Church will emerge as the largest Christian practitioner of segregation. African-American Catholics find themselves relegated to segregated pews, excluded from religious life, and in many instances, pushed out of the institutions that their enslaved labor and the sales of their enslaved ancestors helped to build. And so for me, we must, as Catholics, always remember that the church itself has, at various moments, had an adversarial position and posture towards the African-American freedom struggle. During the civil rights movement, the bishops were the last to endorse the Brown decision. They wait 4 years. They are the last among the American, the major religious denominations in the United States to endorse the Brown decision. And the fact remains is that many white Catholics were the foot soldiers of the backlash movement to the civil rights movement in the 1950s and the 1960s. Now, I've said a lot, but I also want to remind you that even though that is the story of the church, there are other stories. So as much as we must remember Roger B. Taney, we must also remember a woman that I think every Catholic should know. Her name is Martha Jane Chisley Tolton. She is the mother of Venerable Augustus Tolton. She is a woman who was born into slavery, into Catholic slavery in Kentucky, sold away from her family as a teenager, as a wedding present, sent to Missouri where she marries another Catholic man and they have three children. After her husband goes off to fight in the U.S. Civil War, just a few years after Roger B. Taney says that Black people have no rights, which the white man is bound to respect, she herself marches her three children from slavery in Missouri to freedom in Illinois. That is the counter narrative that we must understand and remember. In her freedom march with her children, she rejects not only the legitimacy of a nation that could justify holding people in slavery, but also the legitimacy of any articulation and expression of Catholicism that denied Black humanity, promoted white supremacy, and upheld slavery. It is this family that will give us our nation's first self-identified Black priest. And so as we remember these stories of Catholicism that failed at its moment to uphold the truest teachings of the church, we must also remember that there have always been Catholics who have understood the true teachings of the church. And I would make the argument that we have to begin to look to these stories, and specifically those that are held by Black Catholics, especially women and girls.
That's beautiful, Shannon. Thank you very much. And not a history that I learned even in college courses on American Catholic history. So informative. To sort of move the conversation to this present day and certainly the summer that we had, Ogechi, I want to turn to you. It's been an intense summer of protests and advocacy. You identify yourself as an activist and a social justice warrior. As a Catholic and as a woman of color, how do you see activism and racism connected to your Catholic faith? And you've also spoken about the importance of being an ally, if you could tell us more about why that's important as well.
So I call myself an activist and a social justice warrior. First of all, looking at the word activist or activism, the prefix is act. So that requires not being passive and really putting your work and faith into practice to stand up for those around you. And I like the term social justice warrior because the fight for justice is truly a fight. I hope that we are working together to establish the kingdom of God here on earth. And we must work as warriors of social justice to protect that kingdom. All of us are not going to be holding spears or holding weapons in the same way if you think of that image of warfare. But I think of the traditional image of warfare and the stories that were passed down to me as a Nigerian American of the agents in war were not just the foot soldiers that did the heavy battle. The agents of war were also the people that were healers, the people that prepared the weapons, the people that fixed the weapons, the people that taught skills to those. So all of us bring our gifts, and that's the beauty of our Catholic faith. We all have unique gifts, and all of those unique gifts have a role in being a social justice warrior. So I would love to demystify that term. It sounds grating, and if it does, pray about it and think about why that grates to you, why the term activism as it relates to racial justice might be grating to you. In terms of being an ally, I like to think of being an ally in three parts. The first part is someone that walks beside someone that is experiencing injustice. In this case, it would be a white person who has that level of privilege, and privilege meaning not feeling injustice as it relates to their race, walking beside their black and brown brother and sister in this fight for justice, unloading that burden with them, thinking of a yoke and helping them hold that yoke as they carry on into this life. The ally can also be someone that uplifts the person of color. Sometimes you have to be silent and help amplify those voices that are seeking out a space to be heard, seeking out visibility. One of the biggest issues in this fight for racism is the dismissiveness or the invisibility of people of color within the Catholic Church. One way to do that could simply be, as if you're a catechist or a teacher, to do like Shannon did and share more of these Black Catholic stories, to share more about the stories of Tolton and saints and blesseds that have not really had the shine that they deserve in Catholic history and Catholic conversations. And the other way to be an ally is to stand in front of, to take your privilege and use it as an armor or shield to protect your black and brown brother and sister, and not as a savior, but as someone recognizing their privilege, recognizing their stance in society and in this country and world that can deal with the judgment, the ridicule, the questioning that might come from speaking up for justice, understanding that it is a burden, it is exhausting to constantly have to not only live a life that you might deal with microaggressions, but have to then advocate for yourself at the same time. As an ally that speaks up for and speaks out in front of, you get to not only take the brunt of the ridicule, but you also get to call out your fellow white people who might not realize or might realize and feel an excuse to do it amongst you. Call them out and advocate for your black and brown brothers and sisters. I often think of the parable of the Good Samaritan. For me, it's not so much seeing my color, recognizing me as a black woman and that intersection that I live in, but reaching out into the margins, reaching out of your comfort zone, not being passive, having those conversations and being willing to make yourself uncomfortable, because I constantly live in states of discomfort. And if you truly are an ally, you take up that burden for your brothers and sisters.
Thank you so much, Agechi. I love this focus on everyone brings their gift and presents that, right? And we see that in the Tolton family, as you talked about, Shannon, and that continues because we know the work of salvation history is still happening among us, right? We're a part of that work. Gerald, I want to turn to you in a particular way. You're responsible for forming young scholars, as you call them, this sort of next generation, that they have a role to play too, right? From sort of a personal experience, how did your students, as they've come back this fall, respond to this summer of violence and protest, the murder of George Floyd? What are some of those qualities you're trying to cultivate in their hearts and minds? And maybe those qualities that could apply to us in this moment as well.
Absolutely. Thanks so much, Jonathan. So one of the things that I jumped right into and realized for my kids and for many kids of color, the death of George Floyd was just another reminder of the first few years of their life. My kids that are in eighth grade can name a victim that has been killed by police brutality. And so I had to sit with that because there's my privilege that I can name a few, but for them, they can name someone every single year. And it got to a point where for them, it was normal. And therein lies the problem. Because if I'm called to work with some of the youngest, most marginalized groups of people, if they have this idea or this thought that this is normal, we need to do something about it. And so one of the things that we really focus on at St. Thomas More is just really building the awareness of the world around them for our scholars. One of the things for them is understanding that we are called to go to the edges of the circle, to work with those that are marginalized. And who better to figure out ways to deal with oppression than those that actually deal with it every single day? If we help them realize that they have power that's within, they can seek out, find out what those systems of oppression are, find the weaknesses in there, knock them down, and reimagine the world to be more just and humane. So one of the things that we try to build at St. Thomas More and our scholars is to first listen, to understand that no race is a monolith, especially the Black race. We're not all the same, we're all different. And we bring things to our culture that makes it so, so rich. And so when we listen for understanding rather than respond, we actually learn some things from other cultures and other races. And so that's one of the first things that we try to do. The other is self-awareness, understanding that we all bring biases, implicit or explicit biases, but it's those implicit ones that we try to hide behind and not realize that racism and racist policies exist. And we as individuals that work within them perpetuate those systems of oppression. And so we have to have that self-awareness, where am I part of the problem? And then one of the greatest things that we do as Catholics, discernment. We love to go and reflect in our private corners and our wee hours of the night. And so we should practice that very often, especially when we're dealing and talking about systems of oppression, when we're talking about what it means to be anti-racist, what it means to identify policies and systems that are racist. So St. Thomas More scholars really focus on finding their power within, working to develop a sensitivity to the design of systems of oppression, and then understanding that they too have power to do something about it.
Thank you so much, Gerald. Father Boxey, turning to you, as a priest, you bring a unique perspective to this conversation and to your everyday life of being both a spiritual father for those at Howard University, where you serve as priest chaplain, but as well a member of that institution of power within the leadership of the Catholic Church as an ordained priest, which historically and still today is overwhelmingly led by white men. What's been your experience as an African-American priest in the U.S. context? You certainly have tons of brother priests who are not African-American. Is your experience different than them? And what are some of the spiritual lessons we need to take with us? I know Gerald touched on a couple of them already.
Great. Yeah. Thank you, Jonathan, for that question. And it's great to be here on this panel with so many beautiful people and this great conversation. I guess I want to start out as saying I love being a priest. I can't imagine myself doing anything else. And I'm trying to get more guys, especially guys that look like me, into the seminary and to consider sort of priesthood. But mostly I've had a very positive experience of priesthood. I have some really good priest friends that are supportive. And I think, you know, one thing that has characterized my experience in seminary and as well as in priesthood is just the experience of being alone, you know, sort of, you know, the only one or one of two in seminary or even in, you know, priest gatherings that I go to here in the diocese or outside of the diocese. Just that experience of being alone. And realizing too that, that the church hasn't always been open or receptive to, you know, Black men in the seminary, Black men in the priesthood. So I carry that, you know, not only trying to be a good priest, trying to have been a good seminarian, but also the challenges of being a Black man in a predominantly white community. And again, how the church hasn't always been receptive or open to that. And one thing that I do carry, and you know, I've carried it for a long time, is, you know, not giving anyone any reason to question my Catholicism, to question my faith, to question my intellect, to question my work ethic, because, you know, the history, you know, shows that so many men, Black men, were excluded. You know, we probably talk about Father Augustus Tolton later on, but were excluded, were mistreated, were disrespected, were kicked out for a number of reasons that weren't justified. So I carry all of that with me as a Black priest, and I'm conscious and always aware of that. And these are things that my white priest friends and white brother priests, you know, they don't have to carry that. I would say also, you know, some of the spiritual lessons that I think that we can, you know, take away from this moment is really going to the patrimony of our church. And part of that is to, you know, be radically Catholic, be authentically Catholic, because we have so much in our faith, in our history, in our tradition, in our doctrines, in our teaching, that provide, you know, what we need in this particular moment, and has provided what we've needed in the entire history of our church. And the first that I would go to is, you know, from the very beginning, you know, our baptismal call, you know, that, you know, that one of all of us being, you know, one as brothers and sisters of one another, sons and daughters of God the Father. You know, God doesn't make any distinction among his children, but yet we have. And so going back to that understanding of what does it mean to be baptized in the Lord, baptized in Christ Jesus, we're all one, we're all equal under the Lord. And the second thing too, you know, the power of the Eucharist, it's the sacrament of unity. And I think we need to realize as Catholics, and there've been a number of studies and, you know, surveys and whatnot, so many Catholics are staying away from Mass and don't really believe the power of the Eucharist and what it means. We need to realize that the power of the Eucharist and how it is capable of transforming hearts, minds, souls, cultures, and societies. And so understanding the power of the sacraments. And I guess one final spiritual lesson, again, in the sacraments is, you know, the sacrament of reconciliation. You know, us, you know, taking that time to discern, to reflect, to confess the sins of the church, to confess the sins of individuals, to confess our own sins, the sins of the body of Christ, and how we have been complicit in this grave sin of racism. You know, and I think it's a great model for us as a church to model for her and her members the spiritual fruits and the gift, really, that is the sacrament of confession. You know, us telling the truth, us acknowledging our failures, our wrongs, where we have rejected, God and one another, and own up to that, and make amends for it. This is part of who we are as Catholics. And I think that, you know, our response to be is, you know, let's double down on our Catholicism. let's really get the message of the gospel and what Christ came to bring. Let's that really actually put it into practice.
Thank you, Father Boxey. I love that image of the sacramental life of the church, baptism, Eucharist, and confession being guiding lights for us to work toward the fullest expression of that. One thing you said that sticks with me is that the Eucharist is that symbol of unity and the expression of unity in the church. But I think we know we're not there yet. We've not arrived at that practice of unity, right? Either in our country, that's very obvious. But I'd say, unfortunately, the church hasn't done much better than the political bickering that's all around us. I think part of the challenge is a perception issue and of experience. So I'm so grateful for each of you sharing that experience that's so challenging. What sticks to me is a recent poll by Pew Research just last month that showed that only 9% of those who identify as Trump voters agree that it's, quote, a lot more difficult to be a Black person in our country than a white person, versus 74% of Biden voters. So not to be political about it, but just to name that we have about half the country that thinks one way and about half the country that thinks the other way, and there's Catholics on both sides. And so I want to sort of speak to that holy tension that we hold people who are presenting themselves for the Eucharist, presenting themselves as the sacrament of confession. who are all baptized as brothers and sisters. And Shannon, I want to start with you. Do you agree that it's more difficult to be a Black person if you were answering that poll? And how can maybe white Catholics understand the reality of those difficulties and maybe the white privilege of not having those difficulties as was named earlier?
You know, it's a very interesting question. Obviously, racism is real. White supremacy is real in our history, and it's also real in our church. I think what is telling about this moment in terms of privilege, right, is the ways in which the history of the church, its engagement with white supremacy, not simply its complicity, but agency in the social construction, propagation, and maintenance of white supremacy, is so unknown to so many people, yet it's documented everywhere. I think there are so many fictions, myths about the church that have been allowed to be deployed to be able to obscure this history. I think about it in terms of sort of slavery itself. Anytime someone has mentioned Catholic slavery, one of the first sort of a knee-jerk response, it's almost a learned response is, but what about Pope Gregory XVI? He condemns the slave trade in 1839. There is the church right there. And it's not that this is a sophisticated defense. For me, what is very striking as a historian is that it's a very flimsy defense. And I don't mean it to be insulting, but the reality is, yes, Pope Gregory XVI does condemn the slave trade in 1839. It's important to remember that that happens 337 years after the trade began. He condemns the trade 32 years after Great Britain and the United States bans participation in the slave trade. It's 6 years after Great Britain passes the Slavery Abolition Act in its American colonies, right? It's also ignoring the fact, right, that the popes actually began to sort of issue papal bulls sanctioning the rise of the transatlantic slave trade and the perpetual enslavement of Africans, and also that authorized the European invasion and colonization of the Americas. It's also noteworthy, right, in that apostolic letter, Pope Gregory XVI does not condemn slavery. He also does not call for an end to the trade. He does not call for an end to Catholics to stop participating in the slave trade or in slavery itself. The trade will continue until 1888 in Brazil, which is the nation that receives the largest number of enslaved people that are transported over that near four centuries of the history of the slave trade. And the church is the largest corporate slaveholder in Brazil, as it is in other parts of the Americas. And so for us, we have to begin to tell what Sister Thea Bowman, servant of God, Sister Thea Bowman, told us to do, and that's to tell true truths about the church. That we have, it's not that this history is hidden. We can find it anywhere in the archives. The church took great records because most enslaved people were baptized into the church. We know that the records are there. We have left this history intact for the most part. We've just ignored the experiences of Black Catholics. But the reality is, because you cannot tell Black Catholic history without confronting the church's largely unreconciled histories of slavery, segregation, and colonialism. So for us, it is a privilege to be able to ignore that history. It is a privilege to be able to say that Black Catholics are marginal, when in fact, much of their history predates that of the vast majority of European Catholics. That the first Christian marriage that takes place in the land area that becomes the United States is between a free Black Catholic woman from Spain and a Spanish soldier. Black people, Black Catholics have been in this church from the very beginning, and they have always understood and articulated an understanding of Catholicism free from racism. And that is what we have to sort of begin to look at. There has been a moral compass in the church. We just have to begin to look to Black Catholics and that history, which is available to us.
So I love the historian telling us to do our history research, which I think is so evident and so informative in this time. I know I've appreciated, even in my local community, learning about the neighborhood next door that had a deed restriction, the local park that I play with my daughter that wasn't open to Black families, that there's history in a global sense of the Catholic Church, but also in our own neighborhoods, that for many of us, especially in the DC area, we have an opportunity to learn that history so well, like you're saying. And that's one way of bringing people to a shared experience or perception of the needs of racial justice. For the other three of you, are there other ways we can create unity in this perception that is so disparate or divided?
Well, I think one of the things is first making that radical choice to wake up. And I think as Catholics, we understand what it means to be radical and to be an anti-racist is to be radical, to be aware that our consciousness has been developed in such a way that we exist in this world that we can simply ignore, as Shannon mentioned, we can ignore our place within these systems of oppression. Audre Lorde said it once, in order for us to really look at our human differences and understand those differences, we can ignore them completely. We can copy one so that we're at the top of the food chain, or we can work to destroy it. But in order to destroy it, you have to make that radical choice, that decision to say, hey, you know what? I am a part of this problem, therefore I should do something about it.
I second what Gerald said. I think a lot of people that are well-meaning Catholics will say, well, I am a kind person. I am not a white supremacist. I am not racist. I smile to you in the pews. I give to foundations. I give to organizations. I tithe. I am a good person. But like I said earlier, just being and calling yourself non-racist is not doing the work and being active in the work of anti-racism. You have to take up that fight. You cannot be passive. And worse, you cannot be on the fence. In these conversations that have bubbled up to the surface since these protests and since these since people have decided to listen and learn, which was the theme for a lot of would-be allies, the step that they stop at is once you've learned, you actually now have to act on what you've learned on. Just reading a book, listening to podcasts, watching documentaries does not do the work of being anti-racist. I spend a lot of time on social media, but tweeting and posting is not doing the work of being anti-racist. The conversation that you have with your family members, especially as we enter into Thanksgiving, those conversations, that real work, sharing what you've learned, making people feel uncomfortable and sitting with that discomfort is where you transform your privilege into practicing being anti-racist. And so I think that if you ever feel comfortable working towards racial justice, you're not doing it right. And so keep making yourself feel uncomfortable and you will think and you will know that you are continuing to do the work. Just like with our faith, if I feel comfortable and complacent as a Catholic, perhaps I'm not doing it right. So I need to stretch myself as well. And that applies to any form of social justice work.
And yet, just briefly, Jonathan, just to bring a scriptural aspect, a spiritual aspect on it, you know, Catholics have been a part of the problem, as Shannon has outlined, and perpetuating the system of racism. We also have to be a part of the solution. And you know, this idea of being reconciled back to God and reconciled with one another. You know, St. Paul talks about, you know, whenever one part of the body of Christ suffers, the entire body of Christ has suffered. And even more so when there, you know, part of the body of Christ has suffered because of the other part of the body of Christ. And so, you know, we must be, you know, repair that damage. We have to be active and intentional about it. And the thing is, you know, we've had precedent in this before, you know, and I would just say compare the sex abuse scandal. You know, we had all of these resources, all of these prayer services, all of these, you know, penance services, you know, millions and millions and millions of dollars that were paid in lawsuits and whatnot, you know, and you know, I was leading holy hours, I was leading prayer services, all these things, and I didn't do any of that stuff. You know, the priest that I know, we didn't do any of that stuff. But because it was sins of the body of Christ committed against the body of Christ, you know, we take on those penances and to make reparation for the body of Christ. That's something that all of us, you know, should be doing. And again, we've seen this before, you know, and so, you know, the sin of racism has been going on for hundreds and hundreds of years. And, you know, we have not done what we need to do to actively combat it. When part of the body of Christ suffers, the entire body suffers, and we have to do something about that.
Thank you. Father Boxley, I want to stay with you talking about the institutional work that surrounds that. In 1968, the National Black Catholic Clergy Caucus released a very sharp statement, a very weighty statement, saying that the Catholic Church in the United States, primarily a white racist institution, has addressed itself primarily to white society and is a part of that society. Can you talk a little bit about the church being a part of white society? And is that true in a church that's increasingly multicultural, especially with the growth of the Hispanic Latino community today? Or and how do we better understand that moving forward?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. that statement was written in 1968. And, at that particular time, this was the sentiment of the Black clergy. Shannon can speak more to the history of it. But again, when you have so many Black men that were denied seminary, that were disrespected while they were in the seminary, the same thing with Black women in convents, the same thing, being relegated to the back of the church, being the last ones to receive the sacraments, not being given the ability to even worship at certain churches. You had to, many Blacks were told, well, you should go to your own church. You're not welcomed here. That was a sentiment that was very real and how people of color, Blacks, experience the church as racist. I think now that, there's a significant amount of demographic shift in our church, and some people are uncomfortable with that. I think that, that we have to be very aware of, speaking to our people. One thing that that we've been struggling with too is, realizing that the church is not just white or not just European. And oftentimes, images that we have in our church are images of Europeans, and that doesn't, that's not my heritage. That's not, those who are immigrants that are coming to the United States. And this whole idea of the beauty of our faith is that it's all about enculturation. It's all about, taking what's good in the culture and elevating that. And for so long, we've only seen one image of Catholicism, one image of how to be church. And that is the standard and that becomes a norm when that is not the reality of where we are as Catholics and believers, and even belies the faith, the authenticity and the genuineness of our Catholic faith. So we have to be incredibly aware of who is in our pews and make sure that we're speaking to the needs, the concerns, the experiences of our brothers and sisters who are in the church together with us.
If I could just also just add on to Father Boxey's response, I do actually want to go back to 1968 for just a second. 1968, the catalyst for the formation of the National Black Catholic Clergy Caucus was the assassination of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., the uprisings that take place, but also in response to a call issued by the Irish Catholic mayor of Chicago, Richard Daley, who basically said to shoot to kill those who were in the streets looting. And it was an important moment. And I should also say, at the founding meeting of the Black Catholic Clergy Caucus, there is one Black nun who will go on to form the National Black Sisters Conference because she is not allowed to join the priest. And she really has to call them to task for their own sort of what she would have called sort of chauvinistic sort of positions towards women. But she is the only woman present and she has to find her way in there. What's significant, right, is not that just simply these men are calling attention to institutional racism in the church, but they are also talking about their own experiences in seminaries and part of what is going to happen with Black sisters as well. These are women who had to desegregate these communities, men and women who desegregated their communities and endured unconscionable racism. There are Black sisters who were forced to profess their vows in the sacristy to not offend white parents so that they could not profess their vows with their white counterparts. Many communities refused to ever accept Black women. They sort of used sort of all kinds of standards that were not used with regard to white women. But also in the wake of Dr. King's assassination, many of these men and women are in convents and in seminaries where white priests and sisters are celebrating the assassination. They are living in white Catholic communities that are cheering the assassination of King. It is a metanoia for them. And so when we are talking about women, these are women who have desegregated their convents, but also when they desegregated their communities, they had to desegregate the convent, the schools that they worked in, the hospitals that they worked in, the oftentimes sundown towns and neighborhoods in which they labored in. So these are people who have intimate knowledge of the ways in which institutional racism worked within the church, and also the ways in which it played out in the urban North, where the Catholic Church had significant power. And these are also Black men who were denied the opportunity to minister in African-American parishes. So that the idea of Black men actually being assigned to Black parishes is a relatively new phenomenon. And it comes as a result of massive protests on the part of the Black Catholic community. The first generations of African-American men who are ordained to the priesthood, if they are lucky, are only allowed to go to Africa or to go to the Caribbean. In fact, the first Black bishop of Ghana is an African-American man who was a graduate of the SVD Seminary in Mississippi. So we need to be very clear. This is not people sort of thinking about this. These were policies of the church denying African-Americans priests of their own race in their communities. And it's why sisters became so important. And so when they release their statements, they are speaking as experts on institutional and individual racism within the church. And so the question, of course, is what does the church look like today? Because in the late 60s and late 1970s, hundreds of Black men and women leave religious life in response to racism. The church loses that moral leadership that we could use at this particular moment. Yes, we saw sort of a renaissance and when we saw a significant number of African-American men appointed to the bishops, but what does that look like now? There's never been a Black cardinal from the United States, and we have to look at the leadership of the church. And it still is similar to what it looked like in the 1960s. And so those are the kinds of questions that we have to ask ourselves. Not only in terms of individual sort of racism and sort of ideas and biases, but also what does this look like on the ground? How many Catholic churches sort of celebrate Black Catholic History Month? How many Catholic institutions have Black studies programs? Where is Black Catholic history being taught on the K-12 level? Where is it being taught on the university level? This is the history of the church, but is it being taught? And so those are the kinds of things that we can look at institutionally, where we can target.
Thank you very much. Oh, real quick, Gerald, yeah.
Real quick. And I think that the most important thing to realize is that as our country becomes more and more diverse, and as a Catholic institution that literally has an education system that's rooted in our Catholic faith, that representation piece matters. Our kids need to know that there are people that look like them within the church, and then they have a space in that, especially for those communities that don't have a faith. If we're called to evangelize, we have to do something about how we navigate the system of racism.
Thank you. We have a ton of questions coming in from the audience. I think this has just been an excellent conversation thus far. But I really like that a lot of the participants are moving to some practical recommendations. I think there's a focus on doing that work to acting, Ogechi, like you said. And Ogechi, let me start with you for this question. Ken asks, how can we address anti-racism formation efforts in Catholic institutions? I know that you work at a Catholic institution. You also teach and educate on the area of diversity. How do we move forward from there? And then to build off that, someone talks about how do you teach about working to shift policies and structures within the church? We'll start with you and go around.
All these questions. Okay, really quickly, I think in terms of formation, and it was said a lot, representation is the first step. You have to be able to see yourself to be able to, seeing yourself in terms of educating about saints, educating about Catholic figures, Black Catholic history is essential so that you feel like you have a part in your growth in the faith as a young Black Catholic. I don't think I learned about many Black saints. I know I didn't learn about many Black saints. And when we look at curriculums now, that history isn't taught. So changing that history and changing the teaching that we give to young people, and not just about when we talk about the universality of our faith, we wanna make sure that we're hitting all of the cultural, ethnic backgrounds that exist, and they're not just their existence, but their contribution, like Dr. Shannon is saying, their contribution to the development of our faith and our traditions here in the United States and globally. In terms of doing the work of changing policies, I always like to piggyback off of the examination of conscience, which is a part of confession. Doing an audit, I used to work previous to working in a school, I worked in a nonprofit space, and they love to audit the heck out of things. And so auditing is a way in that space for you to analyze the systems that exist in your organization. And so doing that internal audit as a parish, as an archdiocese, as a community, doing that internal audit as a family, as a program, as a ministry, that audit will tell you many things. The most important is, are we seeing everybody that the church should be seeing? Are we seeing all the ethnic groups? Your church may not have Black parishioners, but you might have a high Asian population that goes unspoken to, unserved, making sure that you're seeing all that you need to see. Do those people that you see have roles of power or influence in your church? And it might sound like a taboo term, but influence is essential in feeling like not only do you have a seat in the pew, but you also have a seat on the parish council, you have a seat on the finance council, you have a seat in the religious education formation. All of these things that we would like to add, religious education, making decision on who speaks to the parish, what small faith groups happen in the parish. There has to be a diversity of voices and backgrounds that exist. So that audit helps you make sure that not only are you seeing who your parish should be serving, but those people are having the voice that they need to have. And finally, you need to do reparations. So it's not enough for you to say, oh, we haven't really been allowing a lot of Black speakers, or we've never had a Black speaker in our parish. You need to own up and acknowledge that sin, acknowledge that mistake that you've made. The beauty of doing that is that those that might feel cynicism in the church will understand that the people of the church are fallible. The church is infallible. The people of the church can make mistakes. And if the leaders of the church can say that we would like to heal and grow in our inclusion as a parish, that keeps more seats in the pews, which I know a lot of parishes are struggling with. That also keeps more of our young voices engaged and active in our parishes, and feeling like not only is it the secular space that can move the needle of justice, but I can really find justice work done in my parish where I should find a spiritual home.
Thank you, Akechi. Gerald, can I go to you next as an educator?
Sure. So as an educator, at St. Thomas More, in partnership with Sacred Heart, we're currently working with Harvard University with a curriculum called Justice by Design, where we're really building in our kids the ability to have that sensitivity to the designs of systems of oppression. And when we give our youngest citizens that tool, they're able to really navigate and see, oh, nope, that's a space where you probably want to change this. And then they're comfortable with that. So we're building that agency in them. It's very crucial with that Justice by Design framework. There's tools that we're using to talk about tough stuff. Yes, an eighth grader can talk about gentrification and how that experience is for them. They can talk about racism and how they navigate with that. These tools are so usable that even at pre-K, we can start having those conversations that we try to shy away from until they deal with it in the real world. But if we start early enough for our kids to have the agency and that sensitivity to know that something isn't right here, we should probably do something about it, they're going to be the ones that go after us to do the real work. And it's a radical choice that we have to make, but it's something that we can do. We have to start early. We have to build that sensitivity in our kids, and we have to help them discover their power within. And I think that we're called to do that as Catholic school educators for sure. And what better place to tie it right back to what Jesus has called us to do.
Thank you. Father Boxier, Shannon, do you want to jump in?
Yeah, just very briefly. I think there's also an incredible need, an urgent need for formation in seminaries and formation in presbyterates on these issues of racism, being anti-racism, and really learning the history of racism in our church. I'm learning. I growing up in South Louisiana, you learn some of these things, but I'm still learning. You know, I've been educated in school tonight. I think all of us have been by Dr. Shannon. I thank her for that. But my white brother priests don't know half of this history. And I think when we acknowledge what the church has done, her failures, her shortcomings, I think that we arm ourselves with that power to go forward and to do something about it, to not simply, you know, rely on the privilege of, oh, I don't know about it, you know, that didn't happen, you know, we're not like that anymore. But arming ourselves with this knowledge, because, you know, knowledge is power, so that we can actually go and do something about it. And really also to be informed about what these issues are, because these are the issues that our people are trying to navigate, are struggling with, and they need some type of assistance, some guidance from, you know, from clergy, from the hierarchy, from our bishops, our priests, our clergy, to help navigate. And how do we navigate these issues, and how do we become well-informed Catholics, intentional Catholics that actually go and do something about this grave sin of racism that we are experiencing?
Absolutely. And if I could say one thing, what's really great about Black Catholic history, right? Yes, we sort of see the racism, we sort of see, you know, the discrimination. What is also there is that story of beautiful faithfulness in the face of that unholy discrimination. When you tell the story of Black Catholics, what also becomes visible, right, are those white Catholics who took the charge to challenge racism. They come forward. Remember, the members of the nation's African-American Catholic sisterhoods, they begin to desegregate Catholic colleges in the decades before the Brown decision, right? They have to get their schools accredited. And so what do? They appeal to the Vatican, and the Vatican begins to identify progressive white people at Catholic institutions, people who come forward to say that racism is wrong. The issue is, we have always had Catholics who have fought this at every turn. Certainly the moral compass has been within the Black Catholic community, but there are also amazing stories of white Catholics who have said, this cannot stand in our church by any stretch of the imagination. But you only get to those stories when you tell the stories of Black Catholics as well. And I say this because I want us to all understand that there is already a blueprint within our tradition. There have been Catholics who have been teaching Black history and Black Catholic history in Catholic schools. They were the Black nuns. They inaugurated the teaching. So if you go to St. Augustine's, right, you can see these elaborate sort of Negro History Week and later Black History Months, and they were teaching Black Catholic history at the same time. We can also look at other examples of people who did step forward to say that, hey, we're going to open this institution and we might get ourselves in trouble, but hey, we're going to do it. What is very significant, right, it has never been sort of a consensus among the Catholic community that racism is wrong, but there has been enough consensus among a small group of people who have always been dedicated to push the church forward. You only need one or two people who are in positions of power to say, we're going to do it, and everybody else is going to fall in line. And I think that's also a part of that story too. So for those of us who may seem overwhelmed by this moment to say that we can't do it, understand what it must have been for Black women living in a slave society to dare to become sisters, to have to do that in their church, to found schools in the midst of, you know, slavery around them. I just want to end with the story of Anne Marie Beecraft, who became Sister Mary Aloysius Beecraft, who has a hall named after her at Georgetown. This is a woman who we now know is the paternal granddaughter of Charles Carroll of Carrollton. And in the midst of the church's slaveholding elite in Washington, D.C., when she was 15 years old, a devout Black Catholic girl, descendant parents who were sort of devout Black Catholics who founded a school for free girls of color in the midst of slavery around her. And she was so devout, so intelligent, so beautiful, so everything, that she got the slaveholding Jesuits and the slaveholding Visitation Sisters to support her school. That is faithfulness. That shows us the subversive power of true faithfulness. And we have, and I want to say that she is just one of thousands of examples that we have within the U.S. Catholic tradition. That is who we need to look to, or at least that's what I would say as a historian.
And also too, just very quickly, you know, that is one of the many gifts of Black Catholics to the church, is our gift of faith. You know, how, you know, persevering, even in the midst of ridicule, discrimination, hatred, violence, and yet we're still here, because this is our church too, and we belong here. So thank you for that.
Thank you. I want to sort of bring this to a coda with two twin questions and for everyone to respond to. The first is, where do you see hope in the church today? And then the second is, what are one or two very practical things that can be done, right? I love that in the U.S. Bishop's Document 2018, Open Wide Our Hearts, they say, racism is a moral problem that requires a moral remedy, the transformation of the human heart that impels us to act. And Ogechi, you said that right at the beginning. So where do you see hope? And what's one or two concrete actions? I'm especially thinking about the person who just goes to Mass on Sunday, right? They might not even be on their parish council, the priest or the pastor might not even know their name to be able to say, we need to increase systems of inclusion. Like, that's a tough conversation to start with. For so many people who want to move and are moved toward that, what's one sign of hope and what's one practical recommendation? And Shannon, I'll start with you. We'll go in the order of our first questions. Putting you on the spot.
I'm hopeful in this moment because there are people who are ready to learn Black Catholic history, sort of in wake of the murders of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor and so many more. I began sort of writing basically editorials calling for the teaching of Black and Black Catholic history in Catholic institutions, because I do recognize that there are many people who sincerely don't know this history. But for me, what I know, and certainly when I teach this history, as soon as I teach it or as soon as I tell a story that someone sort of doesn't know, they're like, why didn't I know this? How is it possible that I didn't know it? What do we need to do to make sure that this is being taught? And so I have been very encouraged by the letters of support from Catholics of all ages, as well as principals and teachers who are like, what do we need to do? How do we get you in here to begin to sort of rethink and revise those curricula? For me, certainly education is absolutely key for us. In terms of making reparation, because we need to understand it. It's not simply that we don't know this history, that it's not been incorporated in sort of our Catholic educational system. It is not a part of our formation programs. And so I've been deeply encouraged by those individuals who have reached out to me to sort of figure out what to do. I think also on a very basic level, right? The first thing that we do, there's a list that I can provide, but what we absolutely have to do is that we have to make, as a church, call upon our church to make formal apologies for its histories of slavery and segregation. It has to acknowledge it. What would it mean if Pope Francis stepped forward to say that we as the church sinned in a grave way by participating in slavery and segregation, and then to sort of make the formal apology? We don't even begin to sort of have conversations around justice until we can even acknowledge it. And then you have to make reparation. But if we don't even sort of have an understanding and an acknowledgement and an apology, I don't think we go anywhere. So I certainly think that that's where we have to start. And I'm just going to say one more thing. And I would say that every Catholic, wherever you are in the world, every Catholic needs to make a pilgrimage to Elmina Slave Castle on the west in Ghana. It is one of the few slave castles that is still standing. And what is very important for every Catholic to see, at the center of the structure, above the prisons, the dungeons in which enslaved people had their lives stripped, their identities and their lives sort of stripped away and stolen from them, is a chapel. It is a Catholic chapel. It is the reminder that the church was there at every moment. Beneath them, as priests offer mass and as others pray in this structure, that there are people undergoing sort of the worst crimes against humanity. Everyone must pay homage to that. We must make pilgrimage to see for ourselves what the church did, but also where we can begin to heal ourselves, to go to that space and make apology. But for me, we have to acknowledge it, and that's one profound way in which we can do it.
Thank you, Shannon. I'll get you to you next. One sign of hope and then one practical action.
For me, I definitely say that I see hope in young people working at an all-girls school. I'm so blessed to be around so many young, bold voices that hold me to task. They see injustices even as young as middle school, sixth grade, and they know their neighbor that has been forgotten. And teaching a class called Charity in Action, we really do need to give these young people tools on how to act. And so in teaching them and in hearing their voices and recognizing their gifts, I find a lot of hope because they will keep us moving towards justice. And a practical tip for anyone that was listening that is that pew Sunday person, if any word or phrase or commentary made you gravely uncomfortable, like that dig deep in your heart, ouch feeling, that's a good thing. That means that the Spirit is moving in you. Dig deep into that discomfort. Feel okay with feeling uncomfortable. Pray to the Lord, pray to the Holy Spirit about how you can work towards and work past that discomfort. Continue to learn, continue to pray, and then act. Act in a practical way. Go visit a Black Catholic parish if you're in the DC area. There's many. Listen to those teachings of those women and men that Dr. Shannon Williams mentioned, and then continue to act and see your neighbor. I always think of the senses, and I ask the Holy Spirit to heighten my senses. How can I see my neighbor more clearly? How can I hear the cries of those in the margins more louder? How can my hands and feet do the work of justice? Everybody, like I said, cannot be that rally cry, but everybody has a role in this work of justice. Choose how you act and start today.
Thank you, Ogechi. Gerald.
So as you both have already said, the children are kids, but I'm going to speak to the Catholic educators that are out there as a fellow Catholic educator. If we really want this work to be done, then we are called to walk into our classrooms and to use our power within to talk about this stuff. And then we are charged to encourage our parents to talk about this stuff. I think the one thing to walk away with, as we've kind of talked about all tonight, is to practice brave community. If you really want to reorient your consciousness in this country, you have to make the radical decision to be aware that there are systems of oppression that exist in this country, within our church, within our schools, within any system. And we have to work together to dismantle those and make the world more just and humane for everybody.
Thank you, Gerald. And Father Boxy.
Just very briefly, two signs of hope. One is Jesus Christ will always be my sign of hope. This is his church, and he said that he will never leave it, and I'm not going to leave it either. Until he leaves it, then I'll make that decision. But I know he's not going to leave it, and I'm not going to leave it either. So he's rooting for us. He's helping us out. He's going to be with us as we move forward in this struggle. And also, too, just a sign of hope. There's this young Black Catholic priest who's the new chaplain at Howard University in the Archdiocese of Washington. And just from the fact of, this position by the Archdiocese of Washington, this one of the preeminent Black educational institutions of higher learning in our country, the fact that there's a Black priest there and the fact that Black Catholic students' lives matter, that gives me hope. Two quick action items. Since this is, as the bishop has stated, this is a moral problem, this is a spiritual problem, it's a twisting, a distortion of the human heart, and it can't solely be solved only by human efforts alone. We need a recreation, a retransformation, this constant conversion of our hearts, of our minds, of our ways of thinking, revealed to us in the person of Christ. And so that starts with prayer. It starts with prayer. And the second action item that I would say is, we sort of talked about it a little bit, but educating ourselves on the candidates that are in the pipeline for the Black candidates that are in pipeline for sainthood. Educate yourselves on them, Father Augustus Tolton, Sister Thea Bowman, Pierre Toussaint, Mother Mary Lang, Henriette DeLille, Julia Greeley. You educate yourselves about that. We're actually doing a program next month, three Saturdays to talk about each of their lives, why they matter, what can we learn from their story, and how can we incorporate their spirituality, Black Catholic spirituality, as a gift to the church, which is for all of us. Educate yourselves about the cause, support their causes financially. Have something being done at your parish to bring awareness to these heroic and courageous individuals. And I even mentioned this, Sister Thea Bowman, she studied at Catholic University. She got 2 degrees from Catholic University. I mentioned to them last week, you guys should have a guild or something to support one of your own who is in the pipeline for being a saint, someone who can be and should be, and I pray that she will be, held up for the entire universal church. And she's one of our own. So thank you.
Thank you, Father Boxy. And I want to thank everyone for joining us tonight for this online Salt and Light gathering and Theology on Tap. Tonight's conversation has been recorded. So if you couldn't write everything down fast enough from all those tips, it will be posted on the initiative's website for later viewing and emailed out through DC Catholic. But first and foremost, I just want to thank our panel, Ogechi, Father Boxy, Gerald, Dr. Williams. Thank you for your wisdom and insight, and I think encouraging and challenging message to all of us, people of color, people of white Catholics. We all have something to learn, and certainly I am taking a lot from the conversation. I just want to close with an excerpt from our Archdiocesan Family Prayer for Justice and Human Dignity. One question came in of what's the Archdiocese of Washington doing. It's in the work. And so I encourage you to go to the website, Made in God's Image, if you Google that, with the Archdiocese of Washington, to learn about resources, both spiritual and practical, and more is coming there as that work is underway this fall. We hope to add a lot more. And so let us pray. Loving and faithful God, we come to you, Father, to ask that through your Son, Jesus, and in communion with the Holy Spirit, you help us in the battle against America's original sin of racism that divides us from being the body of Christ that we are called to be as your children. Hear our prayer and give us the courage, compassion, and perseverance to root out any form of injustice within our communities and to bring the healing love of Christ to all in need. Amen. I also want to thank Kim Daniels, John Carr, Anna Misla, and the Initiative on Catholic Social Thought for being such great partners with the Archdiocese of Washington and in tonight's co-hosting. And to thank all of those that coordinated this evening, including Kyle and Woodra and technical support, as well as Christina for providing tonight's ASL interpretation. Thank you very much. Thanks to Molly Herrera, Program Director for Young Adult Ministry in the Archdiocese, for co-hosting tonight's event. To learn more about Young Professionals Outreach, Young Adult Ministry in the DC area, including a listing of over 40 small communities and book clubs that are launching this fall, including one by Ogechi for Black and Indigenous people of color, visit dccatholic.org or text DC Catholic, no spaces, to 84576. That's 84576. And finally, the Initiative on Catholic Social Thought is not done. They have two upcoming gatherings in the coming weeks, including next Tuesday, October the 20th. The Initiative will hold an online public dialogue on faithful citizenship in the 2020 presidential election as a part of its series on faith and the faithful in U.S. politics. It'll include Emma Green from The Atlantic, grassroots organizer Karina D'Avila, pro-life leader Mary Fiorito, and the Initiative's own John Carr. And the following week on Tuesday, October the 27th, the Initiative will hold an online public dialogue on Election 2020, the moral and public obligations of political winners, losers, and the rest of us. And that will be featuring President Obama's Chief of Staff, Dennis McDonough, and other leaders. So thank you all very much for joining us, and best of luck for not only finding hope in the church, but also doing the work to bring that hope to reality in Christ. God bless you.